Welcome to Dateline Health. This is Fred Lippman coming to you from NOAA Southeastern University. We've had, by news coverage and otherwise, and you might have heard of the so-called flesh-eating disease, necrotizing fasciitis. And it's not a pretty subject matter, but I think it's important enough for us to discuss it so that we can avoid certain opportunities, per se, for you to avoid contact with the flesh-eating disease bacteria. So this show is for your benefit, as I try to keep you as well as possible, and we have the experts. First, let me introduce to you Dr. Bindu, Mayi, who is a professor of microbiology. She's with the Kiran C. Patel College of Osteopathic Medicine. Welcome, Dr. Mayi. Welcome. And I got to tell you, one of my all-time favorite people, because she's, not that you're not favorite, but she's one of my all-time favorites. Jill Wallace-Ross, Doctor of Osteopathic Medicine. She's the Assistant Dean for Osteopathic Clinical Education, and she's also with the Kiran C. Patel College of Osteopathic Medicine. Welcome, Jill.
Thank you so much for having us today.
Good to have you.
Thank you.
I'm going to start out with you, and we've had a number of really interesting, if not frightening, requests from the audience. We get a lot of questions from the audience, and they want to know what is this all about. You know, I mean, I live in Florida. I want to go to the beach. I hear all these things. This beach is closed. This one is this. This is that. And a lot of it has nothing to do with what we're going to talk about, but a lot of it does have something to do with what we're going to talk about. So let's start with you.
Sure, and thank you so much for bringing this topic to your show to inform the people who live here in South Florida and beyond, because we do want the public to be aware of what the reality is and how to keep themselves safe. So necrotizing fasciitis are two really long words that I would like to explain first so that people can get another understanding of what it means and follow along with the conversation. So necrotizing is when there is some kind of tissue damage that leads to tissue death, and you see that death along the tissue as something progresses. With necrotizing fasciitis, the specific bacteria have toxins within them that when they are released, they cause this necrosis to happen. They have a predilection for this area of our body called the fascia. That's why we call it fasciitis, because it's the fascia. Fascia is a name for connective tissue that surrounds different parts of our bodies. And in this specific case, in necrotizing fasciitis, the fascia that are affected are the layer of tissue that surrounds the muscles in the different places in our body, our arms, our legs, our neck, head, abdomen, and so on. So the necrotizing fasciitis condition is death of this tissue deep within the body that you may or may not be able to see. So in terms of what we're seeing in the news about necrotizing fasciitis and the flesh-eating bacteria, are there a very specific bacteria that are out there that if they get introduced into a susceptible host, meaning an individual who has a cut, a scrape, some kind of injury on the outside, but also has something wrong with them internally, that their immune system might not be working so well, or they're on medications that prevent the immune system from working functionally, they might not be able to fight off the little things that come in. And so this bacteria, when it enters, it takes hold and just runs its course really, really rapidly. So a lot of people do go out to the beach. They get cuts and scrapes and things of that nature. We do in our daily lives anyway. But for necrotizing fasciitis, the thing that differentiates a normal cut from something that is progressive and very quickly progressive is that if it's something that you can see on your skin, if it's a cut that's visible, then you usually see it growing very rapidly within the first 24 hours. And that first 24 hours is very important to see the growth of an injury. It may be 48, but usually within that first 24 hours, we see it rapidly progressing. Additionally, there may be that someone doesn't have a cut on the outside and doesn't see anything on the outside, but has a very, very, very tender spot And when they touch it or poke it, it is way more tender and painful than they would have anticipated based on not seeing a cut, not seeing a wound. And necrotizing fasciitis can happen like this. It can happen from the inside out, that you don't see anything on the skin, but you see a person comes in complaining of a very, very tender spot on their body that seems to be progressing. So with this necrotizing fasciitis, the reason we get concerned about it is because we have seen that it progresses very rapidly, and the longer you wait to get treatment, the higher the mortality rate is going to be in the end.
Well, the reason we got so many questions is because, you know, the headline news is that someone dies. Mm-hmm. And people want to know, you know, what is this? What is this flesh-eating disease? What is it all about? Now we got the expert. Here she is. This is Bindu Mayi. Now, many of you might remember that I brought Dr. Bindu Mayi here when we had the Zika problem. And she became really Florida's national expert on the Zika issues. So who better to tell us what the problems really are, although Dr. Wallace-Ross, you've given us a good entryway. So Dr. Bindu Mayi, it's all yours.
Thank you. I really like what you said, entryway, because that's exactly what happens with the bacteria. They have to find an entryway into our body. So that's the most common type of necrotizing fasciitis. And then I'll talk about the one that comes from the inside out. So our skin is a very formidable barrier against infections. If we compromise that in any way, whether it's a cut, it could be a minor cut, it could be a major cut, trauma of some sort. But once we breach this integrity, bacteria can then go in. Once they go in, it's a rich nutrient source for them, and they can start growing. But also, as Dr. Wallace-Ross pointed out, what's happening to the person's immune system? Are they immune compromised in some way? Do they have diabetes? Are they on cancer chemotherapy? Are they on immunosuppressive regimen of some sort? So the two factors come together to create this infection. So what's happening in Florida is a particular type of bacterial infection that causes necrotizing fasciitis called Vibrio. Vibrio bacteria, and particularly Vibrio vulnificus, grows in marine environment. It can be found free living in the seawater, and it can also be found in shellfish, which is why the lady who stepped on the shellfish and got a cut ended up succumbing to it. It can also be found in brackish coastal waters. So as the ocean temperatures are rising, we are seeing more and more incidences of these bacteria causing necrotizing fasciitis infections. And the problem is twofold. One, these infections are happening more and more, but two, they're not being diagnosed early enough because we are not thinking about it. And third, our demographic here might be in the elderly population, and the elderly population traditionally have more of what we call comorbidities, types of diseases that may bring their immune system down than someone who's in his 20s or 30s or 40s, for instance. So what we have to remember here is if we have any kind of a cut or a scrape or a blister or a burn, keep it covered. Keep it dry, keep it covered until it heals. If you have an infection or an open cut, don't go into the water. Make sure you minimize your contact with seawater, hot tubs, whirlpools, swimming pools, so you minimize the opportunity for these bacteria to get past your skin and into your body. Good hand hygiene is a must. Whatever you do to shore up your immune system, whether it's eating right, exercising, de-stressing, sleeping enough, all of those things factor in to just give you a general sense of well-being.
Let me ask you a question, because you know the state of Florida has the greatest number of swimming pools in our state than any other state in the union. Mm-hmm. Are you telling me that this particular bacteria could be in the water in a home swimming pool?
So it's not just Vibrio we are talking about. So Vibrio is just one bacterium. There are other bacteria such as strep pyogenes, which causes strep throat, right? One of the things it can cause. It can cause a whole slew of other infections, including necrotizing fasciitis. So where is strep pyogeny is naturally found. It's found on our skin. It's found in our in the back of our throats. In some individuals, it goes on to cause an infection. In other individuals, they just carry it on their skin, in their throats, but it doesn't make them sick. But they can certainly give it to somebody else who may be vulnerable. So we can pick it up from the water. We can even pick it up from food. It goes on to cause maybe foodborne diseases, but these bacteria are in the environment. So I think the most important thing is for us to know our body, how healthy are we, are there any cuts or scrapes, which sometimes it's not so easy to do if someone has diabetes and they don't have good feelings at the very tips of their fingers or toes, and they stub on something or step on a nail and they don't even feel it. So to answer your question, Vibrio is one bacterium, but there are all these other ones that may be in the swimming pool, or we may come in contact with people at the gym. So good hygiene. If you are using public facilities, take a shower immediately afterwards. Most of these can be easily washed away with soap and water.
Dr. Joe Wallace-Ross, how does one keep that pool safe?
In terms of keeping our families safe, if we have swimming pools in the backyard and not knowing if it may or may not contain anything that could be dangerous, I would say make sure you have weekly service for your pool, it's not green, that it's well kept, that the temperature is well kept, and watch out for your family and your children. Take a look at them each time they go into the pool. If you see that they have cuts and scrapes, you might want to say, okay, well, maybe we'll just soak your feet, you can't go all the way in, or we'll wait until tomorrow, or try to be smart about the water activities. But being here in South Florida, this is a destination for a lot of families to come down for the swimming pools and for the beaches, as well as for all of us who live here year-round. We have the opportunity to go into the water more months of the year than a lot of other places. So I think a lot of the things that we need to discuss are ways of preventing cuts and scrapes to begin with and being aware of ourselves before we go into the water. For instance, people might not think about the fact that going to the beach, a lot of people shave. Men and women alike will shave their chest, their back, their legs, their underarms, their bikini area. And cuts in those areas, especially in the bikini area, can be very serious and very deadly very, very quickly. So if you are going to be going into the water, you may want to consider using something different instead of a razor. Maybe using some other kind of hair removal like Nair or some other product. But anything that can minimize the destruction of our barrier, of our skin, is something that can help. We also have to consider that our hands touch lots of things, and our hands then help us to eat, and we might touch our face, we might touch other parts of our bodies. So hand washing, as we should be doing just to prevent the normal spread of any other bacteria or viruses, you know, just regular hand washing, washing yourself with soap and water, as Dr. Mayi said, coming out of the pool or out of the ocean or out of a lake or any other type of water activity, washing off with soap and water is always a great idea. But really taking the precaution on the front end and recognizing, okay, I have these cuts, I understand that this bacteria may be here, maybe I'll wait a few days before I enjoy this activity. And if you have a cut that seems to not be healing and progressing, that's really the time when you need to be seen by somebody quickly, because this disease is something that progresses very quickly and the mortality rate increases the longer you wait for surgery.
Let's get back to it, Dr. Mayi, because people are worried, and I think we want to try to not minimize their anxiety, but I want to minimize their non-knowledge. So let's go at it again relative to the issues.
I think the issue is twofold. One, what we can control. So if we notice that the integrity of our skin is compromised, for instance, then we can make sure that we keep it covered and we minimize contact with the external environment that we may not be able to control. So the external environment may expose us to these Vibrio bacteria or other types of bacteria that can then get into the skin. So if we do our due diligence, which is good hand hygiene, good personal hygiene, making sure keeping all cuts and scrapes covered, making sure if we have a chronic condition, such as diabetes or liver condition, kidney function, kidney abnormalities, we manage them. We manage them with the appropriate medications. So let's say in spite of all that, we do notice just a minor cut. Let's say we go for a walk on the beach and step on something and notice, oh, I just bruised myself. Then monitor that. If it starts to, usually within hours, with necrotizing fasciitis, within hours, you will notice that the affected area, there will be some intense pain and tenderness in the affected area, which then keeps on progressing. One of the cases that I read about in media was about this gentleman who initially had flu-like symptoms, which then rapidly progressed, and he's battling for his life in the hospital. So the initial symptoms may be nonspecific and may make you think, oh, it's just the flu. So what are the symptoms? It could be fever, stomach ache, diarrhea, chills, sore throat. And then the clue is that affected area where you had the cut or the laceration or the bruise that keeps getting red. The redness grows, it becomes swollen, it becomes shiny, discolored. There may be blisters that develop on it. All of these are concerning signs. And the pain is a tremendous indicator that something's not quite right because it's so intense that it feels as if it's a pulled muscle of some sort. But the trick is in you knowing that you stepped on something or you got a cut and now that cut is giving you this tremendous pain. So if you seek medical evaluation immediately, it really improves your chances of successfully treating necrotizing fasciitis because it's just a rapidly progressing infection. So the sooner you catch it, the sooner you can stop it.
Well, that leads back to you, Dr. Wallace-Ross. Where does one... when they notice that issue, it's swollen, it hurt, who do they see?
Because of the rapid progression of necrotizing fasciitis and the increased mortality with the longer you wait to seek treatment, we recommend going directly to an emergency room. The treatment of choice for necrotizing fasciitis is surgical debridement within the first 24 hours, as soon as they recognize that they're having an issue, as well as broad-spectrum intravenous antibiotics. So somebody who is having this condition needs to go to the hospital because that is where they will get the best treatment to try to improve their chances of recovery. Some of the things that Dr. Mayi was talking about in terms of that would lead to an increased risk of either mortality or becoming infected in the first place are issues of immunity if the immune system is compromised either by an illness or immunosuppressant medications, diabetes, and whatnot. Also, age over 60, and since we have an older population, if they have the other illnesses, they are going to be more susceptible. In general, the healthier, immunocompetent individuals who happen to encounter one of these pathogens, they are likely to be able to fight it off and not to become sick or to perish from the illness itself. The difficulty happens in just recognizing, oh my gosh, this is getting a whole lot worse really quickly. One of the things that Dr. Mayi and I discussed before coming today was how can we help to teach individuals about that if they happen to see something and they don't know if it's growing or not. A lot of us have cell phones now, so we can take a picture with a ruler, and if you don't have a ruler, just take a marker and draw a circle around it. If it's getting bigger in the next few hours, go to the hospital and have somebody take a look at it. I would say you'd rather be safe than sorry when considering we have seen this in the media, and we know that the mortality rate can be as high as 60% if treatment is not sought quickly.
Let me stay on that for a minute. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, a lot of the folks that have asked us questions about it say, well, what you gave me the answer. I mean, get yourself to an emergency room in a hospital. That's basically what you're saying, because you can't wait. You can't wait through. You go on a Thursday or a Friday or a Saturday, and then you can't wait until Tuesday to see a doctor. Is that correct? Yeah. I mean, do I hear that from you, Dr. Mayi?
Yes. Yeah.
Dr. Joe Ross Wallace, that's really what has to happen. I mean, you got to get yourself over to an emergency room situation. Am I on the right track?
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
And I think that one of the challenges that we have here in Florida is that we do have a lot of people who live in the state part-time. So they may have a primary care physician here in the state, or they might not have one here in state. But with this particular illness, no matter what, if wherever your doctor may be, it's most important that you get seen at a medical facility, that going to the ER is the place to really go if you are concerned about this specifically. Emergency rooms all over the country will provide the result and the documentation of everything to your primary care doctor, wherever you may live, so that they can continue the care afterwards. Because if there is surgical debridement that is necessary for the necrotizing fasciitis, there's going to be a lot of follow-up, a lot of wound care, and a long regimen of recovery after the fact. It may be months. And so there will need to be coordination between whoever was the initial treating physician at that hospital and the primary care doctor or the multiple physicians that a patient may have, including any of their specialists.
Dr. Bindu Mayi, is there anything on, I mean, is there any work being done in the world of research to find agents other than some massive amounts of what people might want to infuse into your body to say, okay, we're going to stop this infection, maybe we won't stop these infections? Is there any research going on relative to this
yes.
disease?
Yes, so we were talking about it previous to coming here. One of the things we are looking at is a vaccine. So one of the strong hitters, the heavy hitters, is the strep pyogenes, which you find on your skin, the back of your throat, etc. But it's a little bit tricky to find a vaccine because there are so many types. So, for instance, just because you have strep throat once doesn't mean you won't get it again. So it changes its structure such that it can trick the body. So we have to take that into consideration. But another thing is, one of the things that strep pyogenes ends up doing when our immune system finds it and tries to fight it, it creates this cross-reaction that can then affect the kidneys, affect the heart, etc. So any vaccine candidate would have to make sure doesn't have these cross reactions. Although there is research being done, it has been tricky to come up with vaccines against some of these horrendous opportunistic pathogens. They wait for the right opportunity and then they attack. But one thing I wanted to mention, you mentioned the increased number of cases down here in Florida. What I wanted to also mention is the Vibrio bacteria that are found in the marine environment, found in brackish waters, etc. The reason why we are seeing an upsurge in that also is because A, the temperatures are getting higher, which promotes their growth. B, as the sea level rises, what that does is it brings seawater, ocean water, further inwards where it can mix with waters from rivers and streams and create this brackish waters, which is the slightly salty water that these Vibrio bacteria absolutely love. Down here, we are in the hurricane zone this time of the year. So what happens if a storm surge comes in and brings in ocean water further inwards? It mixes with waters. We have flooding and we have slightly salty water. And people might be wading through those waters, trying to get to higher ground or trying to get to the shelter. So what if you have cuts or open wounds and we have to keep them covered? So all of those things increase our risk here just a little bit higher than I think the rest of the country.
Well, it's not a really happy subject, but I think it was a very important subject to bring to the people. In fact, your last few sentences really heighten, I guess, the potential anxiety that people would have because we are into the hurricane season. And we do know that we do have rising waters. I mean, forgetting the politics of it, the bottom line is that if you lived in Fort Lauderdale or Hollywood or Hallandale or otherwise, you can see the water is rising. We have these high tides and everything that are not just, it happens. We're seeing it. We have to do something about it as a society. We have brains, we have knowledge, and hopefully we have money to do something about it. And I appreciate both of you for being here. It's a very difficult subject matter, but we've had these like I said, really tough questions that have been put to us. And I didn't know where to turn to, except I figured it out. There's the expert here, and there's the medical common sense expert sitting right in front of me. So, Dr. Bindu Mayi, thank you very, very much for showing up again and being part of our knowledge base here at Nova Southeastern University. You are a professor of microbiology and now in the college, the Kiran C. Patel College of Osteopathic Medicine. And Jill Wallace-Ross, you are the assistant dean of the College of Osteopathic Medicine. And we want to thank you both for your service and your advocacy to try to keep the people well. And that's what this program is all about. So, folks, I tell you, whether it's turning up at the emergency room or whether it's going to a doctor's appointment or whatever you come in contact with a health professional, you got to let them know what you're being treated for by another health professional or what you're taking over the counter, what you're buying in the pharmacy or the supermarket or wherever. You got to let people know. They have the knowledge to separate the potential problems that are inherent to what you're putting together to make yourself better. So take good care of yourself. I always try to tell you that it's up to you to stay well, but you got to use your mouth and your brain to let these people know what is happening with you the time that you're not in their offices or in front of them. Thank you again for showing up. This program is called Dateline Health. We come to you from Nova Southeastern University. My name is Fred Lippman. Until next time, see you.